Last time we started at the top with Ho-Oh, and this week, let's go all the way down to the bottom with Igglybuff. Now, let me just say up front that Igglybuff is bad. I did a Jigglypuff video that's very dated, and my main point in the intro of that video was that Jigglypuff's stats are so deceptively bad because of its high base HP stat. Now, Igglybuff is just like that, like you would expect, but worse. Out of all Generation 2 Pokemon, it has several stats that rank anywhere from the very bottom of the list to bottom three, and the biggest culprit as to why it's so awful is that 15 base speed. There's a lot of things that make Igglybuff bad, but I don't think it is the worst Pokemon, however, because it has two redeeming qualities. Number one, it is in the fast leveling group. That is very good. We'll be leveling up very quick to get past our problems, and it's a normal type Pokemon. Therefore, it gets stab on an early headbutt and on return, which most people consider the most busted move in the entire game. And before we really dive in, let me just go ahead and say that I do Pokemon solo run content often, and if that is something that sounds like it would be interesting to you, consider subscribing to be kept up to date. Now, likes and comments really go a long way to help small channels grow. So if you are a new viewer or a returning subscriber like Phrase Odyssey, just scroll down and type in the worst balloon, because it's just going to be a struggle today. And with that out of the way, let's just sit back. You can grab yourself a Sody Pop today, and let's just start talking about what makes Igglybuff such a hassle. If you remember the god-awful hop-up run I did in Crystal a long time ago, you'll know that hop-up cannot attack any Pokemon at the start of the game, and you have to deplete all your power points and level up a little bit before you can actually kind of begin the run. And the same thing happens here with Igglybuff. We start off with Sing, Charm, and Defense Curl, and we do not get an actual reliable move until level 9 with Pound. So what we have to do is find a Pokemon that you can comfortably deplete all your power points on. Now, the first thing we do is we go into the mart. We spend all of our money on potions so that we can stay in struggle strats as long as we can. And then our next mission is to find a Hop-Up, because it cannot hurt you back. It is by far the safest Pokemon to deplete your power points on. This might sound a little bit tedious, and it is, because there's only a 1 in 20 chance to encounter a Hop-Up in Crystal, and that's only during the daytime. And with such low base speed, even things like the Pidgeys that you encounter will not allow you to run away all the time, and you'll just take little slow chip damage, and it's rather annoying, but eventually you will find a Hop-Up. If you utilize Sing and then just kind of alternate between getting rid of all your power points, it's really not that bad. It's just a little bit time consuming, and then once you finally get through all that, you're finally ready to go ahead and start using Struggle so that you can try to get up to that level 9 mark. Now, like I said earlier, we are in the fast leveling group, so it's really not that bad. Eventually, I move over close to Mr. Pokemon's house, and I do this because it's much more efficient, because you will get a free heal when you go in here and trigger the dialogue. And once you do that, we can finally kind of begin the run at about 8 minutes in. It's not the ideal start, but Igglybuff isn't that great anyway. And just if you're kind of just wondering here, the main reason to choose Igglybuff is because we started at the top, we learned the game very well, we had a very excellent run, and now we are at the other end of the spectrum to see how much struggles you can really get into, I guess. And this is like another side of the coin to learn the game for me. Anyway, after that, we can move all the way down to the rival, and since we are level 9, it's really not that bad. Igglybuff stats might be god awful, but when you almost double the level of your opponent, it really doesn't matter, and that might be a theme that we're looking into today. But we get past this one, and we can kind of just jump ahead a little bit. It goes without saying that Igglybuff is not Ho-Oh, and I will not be doing the bare minimum battles here. In fact, starting from the very first route, whereas Ho-Oh skipped all but one of the battles to do the one mandatory battle to progress, I will be battling every single thing here, including little youngsters here. It's not really a challenge, but we just need all the extra levels and extra power that we can get in this early game. Now, as I play more Crystal runs, there are certain little addendums I'm going to make to things that I said in the previous video, and the first thing I would like to say is that it it's much more efficient to go ahead and get a cut user. I don't even like to entertain the idea of Paris for Dig anymore. I think it's a huge waste of time, and no matter how you slice it, unless you're pausing the game, it is much slower than just buying escape ropes later. So I go ahead and get the cut user here, and that's why, if you're wondering, it's very slow to go get Dig. Next up is something that we talked about on the last video as well. I talked about how I don't make my Pokemon do Sprout Tower, but in the case of a Pokemon this week, I do need extra levels, so I will go ahead and just take out pretty much every trainer inside of here, and when it's all said and done, I do reach level 14. It's not that bad, it's just if you go into Faulkner and you're susceptible to Mud Slap, it's gonna be very annoying, and we just don't have the power to make it through. And since we're in the fast leveling group, there's no reason to not go ahead and take on these extra challenges early. And with that said, we can now take a look at Faulkner. And there's not really much to say about this one. With the extra levels, we can two-shot the first Pidgeotto, so it's not an issue. And even though Gust is pretty powerful, you gotta remember that Igglybuff has one thing going for it really in terms of stats, and that's its massive HP pool, and I can tank it. Even though I get down very low at the very end of the fight, I'm able to outpace the Pidgeotto, and at the end of the day, I take the first badge with my very first victory of the run. Learning Mud Slap will definitely help looking ahead to Union Cave, and while we're going through this next little boring bit, I'd like to just talk about something off the top of my head real quick. This is my second Crystal video. I'm trying to get really good at the game. I feel like I've done a great job. I've done a lot of runs behind the scenes, and I appreciate comments that genuinely go out of the way to give me some type of advice or tell me something that I did wrong or something like that. That's like in a constructive way. Now, there are other kind of comments, and I'm sure every content creator can deal with this, is that there's over analytical people that think that, I don't know, just being really nitpicky and just overall kind of obnoxious is a way of helping, and it's really not. I've had a couple of these kind of comments over the last month, more than a couple, probably like 10, but some people get full-blown like mental breakdown when you say something back to them. And if you're that mentally unstable that if you can't, like if you're being an asshole to somebody anonymously on the internet and they say something back to you and you just have a full-on mental breakdown about it, get over yourself. Get off the internet, get off the channel, and try to be constructive. That's really all I want to say. It's just something that kind of like, it's really funny to me. It's actually hilarious to me. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. I just wanted to bring that up real quick. I don't even know why I said that. Anyway, let's keep it moving. We don't even have to look at Union Cave, and instead we can just skip straight to Azalea Town. Now overall, I have one reset on Hiker Anthony, which there's no shame in that. Hiker Anthony's one of the most obnoxious trainers in the entire game. And after we do the Rocket Hideout, save all the Slowpokes, we can then just take a quick look at Bugsy. He leads with a Kakuna and a Metapod. Now, no one cares about those Pokemon. They're the weakest, most pathetic Pokemon in existence, and they're not gonna do anything to me other than make me upset and waste my time. So let's skip ahead to what the battle's really about, and that's Scyther, and do we have enough HP to withstand the buildup of Fury Cutter? The initial thoughts for this one was to put it to sleep and then go to Pound Town, but halfway through it wakes up, and I'm like, well, I got enough HP just to roll through this one real quick, and it gets really close at the end, but the strategy does pay off. And even though we do have that one reset on Hiker Anthony, we don't have to reset once again, and that's our second badge down. I guess it's really not looking that bad. It is kind of taking a little bit of time, but Igglybuff doesn't seem that awful, I'm sure, just yet anyway. Now guys, let's quickly talk about this rival battle when you're leaving Azalea. Now there's some huge problems here. We only have one way to deal with ghost types, and that's Mud Slap. It's incredibly weak. And on the first attempt, it is annoying, you can tell. I get put to sleep and it's just overall unpleasant. But what actually ends up getting us on this attempt is the Zubat. We get confused and we hurt ourselves a bunch, and then we get crit at the very end, and that forces our first reset. Now what normally happens here, and what we see on our second attempt, is that if you get off a Mud Slap and then you get put to sleep, The Ghastly will start to use Spite on you, and it'll drain all the power points of Mudslap to where you have no way to actually do damage to ghost types, and it's just kind of a forced reset, and it's kind of annoying. Now, let's cut a long story short here. Let's pick all the way back up on reset number 5 here, and we can talk about what actually worked. I had to actually utilize the Sing strategy. I had to kind of do what the Ghastly did to me, and that's why it took me a few extra tries, because it's just not that reliable. Eventually, I get it put to sleep, and I'm able to just kind of have my way with it with slapping around with some mud, and eventually we do get to this fight. It's not great, and it's kind of like a foreshadowing of how we're going to have to deal with these ghost types later, and it was kind of a wake-up call that I still need more levels with Igglybuff. Now, as of now, the run hasn't been awful. Now, there are going to be some awful spots coming up, but this is kind of like just a quick glimpse on how things can really get out of control with Igglybuff in a bad matchup that you don't see coming. Next, let's start talking about some mistakes that I've made. Now, earlier I said I had to set the time today so that I could find a hop-up, and here it cost me. I kind of underestimate how much time it would actually take, and here you can see that I have about 11 minutes until it's nighttime, which means I cannot catch my Psyduck just yet, so instead of just waiting around, I'm just going to go ahead and get through this part of the game, and I'll take a backtrack, and I'll go ahead and I'll get my HM Pokemon after that. It is worth noting in the footage here, I do find a Paris, but like I said earlier, I think Dig is a massive waste of time, so I don't do it. And outside of that, for Ilex Forest, Headbutt is pretty key. 70 base power, 105 effective power move with Stab. Very good. It's a huge power boost for us this early in the game. It's really going to come in handy because we have some pretty tough fights coming up, but since we can't catch our HM Pokemon, we kind of messed up the time. All we can do now is go ahead, and I do battle pretty much every trainer that I can on the way to Goldenrod. There's several littered around that I normally wouldn't battle, but with Whitney coming up, we need all the help that we can get. As far as Goldenrod goes, we do the normal errands that I talked about, things like getting the Abra, getting the Kenya, going into the underground, and then heading north to fight a bunch of trainers. That's something that we do today, but there is a more efficient route that I didn't touch on last time because I thought you had to go to the national park, but that's not really the case. I would like to once again give a huge shout out to Juggler Irwin, who has a level 2 Voltorb, guys. Level 2, this stage in the game, he has a level 2 Voltorb, so special shout out to my guy here thinking that he can do some work with that. Alright, so here, instead of going to National Park, if you just take the right path here, you should probably use a repel. I did not use a repel, kind of a mistake, but in a run like this where there's so many mistakes, it doesn't matter. There's one trainer to fight, and if you just loop down to the bottom, there is the TM for Rollout. Now, Rollout has a very special interaction that we'll talk about with Defense Curl, you might already know, but I mean, if you want to beat Whitney, you gotta fight fire with fire, you gotta roll out with the rollout, and just in general, this way, even if you wasn't getting rollout, it's much quicker just to battle the one trainer, cut the bush, and you'll be right there where you were if you were to go through the whole of National Park. And if you don't need things like the Quick Claw or Dig or something like that, this saves a lot of time. Inside of Whitney's gym, I do battle every single trainer that I can get my hands on as well, because I just know our speed will be a huge detriment for the entirety of the run, so I just need to always be battling stuff. ABB is what I like to call it. And after that, we can finally take a look at Whitney. And this one's going to be quick, and I'd like to just quickly talk about the interaction between Rollout and Defense Curl. So Rollout is a 5-turn move. Normally it'll do 30, 60, 120, 240, 480, and that'll end the turn right there. So 480 base power at the end. Now if you use Defense Curl anytime before that, it'll double the starting total. So you'll start it with 60, and since it doubles, that means it can go all the way up to 960 base power. What this means is that it's extremely powerful if it gets going. And the idea here is to get it started on the Clefairy, and once you get a couple of those down and get it knocked out, all of a sudden you're at stage 3 of Rollout. You are doing 240 base power with your move, and it shouldn't take more than one or two turns to take out the Miltank. And that's exactly what happens here. It doesn't look that bad, but Rollout and Defense Curl are kind of one of those little buggy interactions that we're more used to from Generation 1. But here it makes this normally really tough gym not that bad, and hopefully I quickly quickly summarize what makes Defense Curl rollout pretty broken. This is a combination you will see a few times in this video, but it's not like I'm going to rely on it a ton. It's just something that you have. If the situation calls for it, you can set it up, and it does a ton of damage and allows you to get past things much earlier than normally would be possible. But outside of that, getting the plane badge, we've talked about it in the last video, I do get a boost to my normal type damage, and that's very good. I don't have that implemented yet. I don't think I've mentioned this, but I do have effective power in my moves now, so you can look at headbutt 105 power. I do calculate that. For the next video, I'm hoping to have things like held items and badges be a part of this calculation too, but I just have not had time to do that just yet, so stay tuned. But overall, Whitney, very important badge to get for normal type Pokemon, and I think that we're going to start seeing a lot of huge returns after this fight. No pun intended, return, get it? Afterwards, I do return to Ilex to get my Psyduck because it is officially nighttime in the game now, and you could probably just get a Krabby. It would pretty much be the same thing, but I just like the Psyduck. Now, I could probably look into more Krabby strats later, and I probably will just as I refine everything overall, but it's worth noting I do get the Psyduck here. Next, I make my way up to Ekrotech City, and the Kimono Girls are the first order of business. Now, they're not really that much of an issue. I don't really have to go over the strategy. I don't have any resets here, but they are just annoying. Igglybuff being just a little bit weak means I can't quite one-shot most of them, and they usually like to go for sand attack, and it wastes a bunch of turns, and overall, it's just kind of an annoying little process. Now, we can move on. We get Surf after this, and in Crystal version, you cannot take on Morty until you take on the rival in the Burnt Tower, and that's a very tough battle. It's something I had on my list from practice runs that I needed extra levels. There was no way around it. Even though I am a decent level right now, I immediately head off to the left and I start battling every single trainer that I can, and I'm going to be doing a lot of optional battles here as I get ready for that rival battle. And from there, I just continue the path down to Olivine to the lighthouse. I take on every single trainer inside there as well, just for all the extra experience, because it's really bad. Being very slow is just abysmal, and it makes some fights pretty much nearly impossible. And this is just generation 2 in a nutshell. Being in the fast leveling group, I'm going to quickly start out leveling everything in my path, but there's just a few battles that are so oppressive and rough that I need to do this. And even when I'm done with all that, I head to the east and I go ahead and I go to Mahogany Town and I go ahead and go to the Lake of Rage. Now, this is another little tiny mistake I made. For some reason, I wasn't thinking about using Surf, and I thought that maybe I could go ahead and get the Gyarados out of the way. Maybe I could go ahead and do the Rocket Hideout segment, but obviously I haven't defeated Morty yet, so I can't do that. But I do get some extra battles, and then pretty much when I'm done with all that, there's really nowhere else to run, and I have to face the rival now. And let's just kind of talk about what makes it so bad, really. And just keep in mind that I'm level 38 here, guys, compared to his level 20 Pokemon. You would think it wouldn't be too bad, but I'm Igglybuff. My stats are atrocious, and it all starts right up front with the Haunter and Curse. I absolutely hate this move, Curse. If you're slow, it's going to absolutely eat your lunch, and that's kind of what happens here, and that's what happened on my test runs. Originally, I wanted to set up a rollout, and I was hoping that by the time I got to the end, I'd have this huge super-powered rollout, and I'd easily go through the fight. But what I ended up doing, and I guess this is as good of a time as any, is I went with Hidden Power Fire for this run. Now, later you might think, hey, I should have went for another Hidden Power type, and I'll tell you why that's wrong later. But Hidden Power Fire just really helps in a few situations, mainly like Jasmine, some of the Magnemites, and all that kind of stuff. Gives nice neutral damage in a lot of situations, but that's neither here nor there. The main thing is that it takes level 38 to be able to get past this one on the first try, and even then, I still go down pretty low into the yellow, and it wasn't great, and considering that I pretty much doubled up on every Pokemon that he has level, it's not great. It doesn't instill confidence in me looking ahead. And now our reward is that we finally get to face Morty, and he has a lot more ghosts with a lot more curses. And we could just quickly go over Morty. You might think I might have some trouble here. I did mention that rollout strategy, and when you don't resist it, the problem with the rival battle was Magnemite just resist rock and it made it really hard to set up and you took a bunch of damage. But here, I absolutely crushed this fight. I'm able to take a curse, I set up rollout, and by the time rollout plus defense curl starts doubling up, I'm able to easily cruise through this fight. It's very easy actually, especially considering how high of a level I had to get to make it past the rival. But this one's a joke. I can now serve, and you might be thinking, oh man, you really overleveled. But guys, would you believe me if I told you that I'm still not high enough level to really do what I wanted to do? And this is where I made the hugest blunder of the entire run right here. You see, in practicing, this next little coming up part, we'll talk about it when we get there. It's the absolute worst part of the entire run, pretty much outside of something a little bit later in the game, but it's one of the worst parts. And what I did to alleviate this in practice was that I went ahead and did some minor backtracking. I changed the time to Tuesday. I picked up the pink bow on the very starting route of the game, and then I went back to Goldenrod and I picked up Return, because since we've done so much extra battles, Return is now doing pretty significant damage ahead of Headbutt. And those two things right there kind of alleviated all the problems I had, and it allowed the next little fighting gym not to be that bad. But without further ado, let's just kind of go down to Cyanwood, and let's just talk about the part that really gave me a lot of headaches. And I mentioned it really briefly earlier, you think maybe Hidden Power Psychic or Hidden Power Flying would help, but Igglybuff is just so weak and pathetic that I couldn't one-shot these Pokemon, so it didn't make a difference, and I was actually doing more damage with just Headbutt, and then when you factor in Return and the pink bow, it was just doing a lot more damage, so it was just kind of useless to even try to do those hidden power types. And this is the part right here that gave me so much headaches in practice. There's the first fighter that you have to go against here with the Hitmonlee, and you're not going to one-shot it for the most part. The most problematic thing is you're not going to outspeed it. It does heavy damage, as you can see, but with all the extra levels, I'm able to one-shot it. And the thing that makes this part so problematic is that you have to fight a trainer directly after him with no breaks between. But luckily for us, Hitmonchan has really bad moves, and it uses its special attack for a lot of its moves, and it's just very low. So here we actually just survive, and on the very first attempt I make it past this part. And at this point I thought, well, maybe I solved one of the huge problems of the run and we could just move forward, and I got this. But let's just take a look at
Brother,
and see how that's not really the case here. Chuck leads with Primate, and there's not much about this fight that can really be said. Just about everything you need to know is right here on the first attempt. I get hit with a Leer, Headbutt does not knock out the Primate, and then a Karate Chop takes me out in a single hit, and that's kind of how this fight's gonna go. And I'm not gonna lie to you guys, I die a ton here. Even if you can make it past the Karate Chop one-shotting you, it just feels like Chuck's Dynamic Punch had like a very high success rate. Now in reality, Dynamic Punch only has a 50% chance to hit, but it feels like it was hitting about 95% chance today, and I had so many resets here, it's not even fair. At this point, I was just letting Jesus take the wheel, and normally I don't really like luck-based strategies, but today I was resetting over and over and over and over because it's faster than backtracking and leveling up more. Now, at the end of the day, I guess while we're watching all these failures happen over and over in the background, I can say that a very smart move would be that since I had Surf, I go back over and I take on the Rocket Hideout now. I go ahead and go to Lake of Rage, trigger the Gyarados, talk to Lance, and do all that stuff. And with a few extra levels, and probably go ahead and get in Return and get in the pink bow like I alluded to earlier, this would have been much easier. But I did forget, I am human after all. I wasn't really worried about this being like a perfectly optimized run because Igglybuff's really bad. But at the end of the day, you need some luck here, and that's all you can really say about it. Dynamic Punch had to miss a couple of times, and eventually I do take the fight, but this was very bad. I have to go all the way up to 22 resets. 22. 22 resets, and the Poliwrath has to miss 3 Dynamic Punches for me to finally get past. It wasn't pretty, it wasn't great, but overall it's kind of like a microcosm of how the Igglybuff run feels, and this is one of the low points of the entire run, and we won't have to go into any kind of luck-based strategies for quite a while because the hardest challenge of the early game or the mid game for quite a while, it's over with. We can start to cruise along a little bit and pick up some speed. And you would think that getting all these resets would slow us down, and it's not the fastest strategy in the world, but getting fly now without having to go ahead and backtrack does save me a lot of time. It allows you to zip around the map. And that's something I really wanted to do more efficiently in this run, but I really didn't want to do a third Igglybuff run. I did 2.5. I didn't want to do another full run, so this is what we're going to get today, and hopefully you guys can overlook the fact that Igglybuff is absolute garbage, has awful stats, and Chuck absolutely ran a train on it. When I'm done with that, I do make a return to the first route of the game to get the pink bow. You can get it on Tuesday from the sisters, and then after that, I do head back over to Goldenrod, and I finally pick up Return. It's better late than never. It's going to be obviously our strongest move of the entire game. And you can see with our friendship at what it is now and the stab bonus, it's already at 127 effective power out of a maximum of 153 when you don't count in the pink bow and the Whitney's badge and stuff like that. I also pick up a couple of vitamins here. It doesn't seem like much, but when you only have 15 base speed, any little help that you can get goes a long way because Igglybuff's going to have to be a very high level to outspeed some late game Pokemon. And now we can just kind of go on some cleanup duty. We've done a lot of extra stuff. We've spent a lot of time. We're already at over an hour. We're not too far off from what Ho-Oh's final entire run was, but we can take a look at Jasmine real quick. And with Hidden Power Fire, I can quickly just go through her team real quick. Even though I'm only level 43 compared to the Steelix, I can do enough respectable damage. And if I needed just a little bit more damage, I could just equip the charcoal for a 10% boost, but I didn't really need it here. And that's another gym down, we don't have to talk about it too much. When that's said and done, we watched Lance kill a man with his Dragonite, and today we're going to be skipping over the entirety of the Rocket Hideout segment, both segments, but in between I do need to take a quick look at price just real fast. And we do have Hidden Power Fire, and I guess his ace is weak to fire, but I mean our return is really strong right now. You see the base power 141, we got the pink bow equip giving an extra 10% power, we have Whitney's gym giving it another 12.5% power, and that's all you really need to know. Price is done with. We got 7 badges down. We're skipping over the Rocket Hideout segment after this. Now, moving ahead towards Claire, did I have some extra resets? Yes, I had a few on all the 100 rocket battles that you had to do, but that's Igglybuff. You take the good with the bad, it's mostly bad. Now, as we go through Ice Tunnel, really the only thing to even note, to even talk about, is I pick up Rest. Rest will be kind of key here, and it's kind of more of a cheap strategy. I don't like the strategy, but we're not going to talk about it now until we get into the later parts of the game. But I do pick up Rest. It will be critical to the end of the game. But outside of that, a couple of resets. Now let's just take a look at Claire. Now for me, I know some of the channels I watch, like Scott, have been talking about doing away with Hidden Power. And I see some comments that say things like, you know, Hidden Power Ice make Claire not a challenge. But look at this fight. I know I'm really over-leveled, but this is an Igglybuff. I just one-shot everything with Return. Return can just dominate anything. So what do you really want? There's not much to really say about this fight. I think if you're going to ban Hidden Power, you're probably going to have to ban Return too. And while you're at it, you might as well ban things like Curse. You might as well ban Rest. But that's just my thoughts on it. I think everything's kind of fair game. I'm not bothered by it. I'm over-leveled at this point, but you've seen the early game and what the lengths that we had to go to be strong enough to make it past Chuck. And it's no surprise that we're over-leveled for a game that's notoriously known for the bad leveling curve. And with all that said and done, we can finally start to take a look at the Elite Four and strap yourselves in because this is not a very good Elite Four. I'm gonna have to think about a way to edit this down to not be completely god awful for me to have to edit, but we'll try our best. Let's take a look at the Elite Four. Let's start off with Will, and I need to talk about a couple of things. The first thing, and it might be a red flag to prepare for what's coming up, is I deposit every single one of my Pokemon minus Igglybuff, and I spend pretty much all of my money on full restore. Stores. And that's because today, the only way that you can make it through the Elite Four, specifically Bruno, is that you're going to have to do some blackout grinding. And nobody really mentioned it in my Magikarp video. Normally, I don't count this sort of thing. But today, I will be tracking the blackouts just so you can get more of an accurate representation on my reset counter. And without further ado, let's just talk about Will. And we'll talk about why the Elite Four is basically impossible for a long time. And you have to get this extra experience by blacking out right here. Thank you. Will leads with Zatu, and you notice the speed disparity. It has 91 speed to my 79, so it will go first. The best case scenario, which is what we see right here, is Confuse Ray. That doesn't affect me, and I just one-shot it with Return. We take it out nice and easy, but normally things don't go that smooth. Next up is Jinx, and once again, it's the same thing. This one can go pretty bad, but if it just goes for like a pretty weak double slap, and I one-shot it with Return, there's nothing to really worry about. And you might be saying, why would you have to grind on the Elite Four? It's looking pretty easy right now. Well, let's enter the Executor. We have Hidden Power Fire. It looks pretty decent on paper. 140 effective power, but Return, like most of the time, most of everything in this run, Return's just going to do more damage. And there's not really any world that a level 62 Igglybuff's going to be one-shotting Executor. And here we can finally see the confusion start to kind of add up just a little bit. I take some psychic damage, and when it's all said and done, I do progress in the fight, but I'm only at 18 HP, and then the Slowbro's coming in, and it's a really bulky Pokemon. I'm not going to be able to one-shot it as well. And this is where we're going to see that I will take the experience, I make a save state, I make a reset, and then I'll reload my save state so that I keep that experience, and I'll keep doing that for a while. And I know I could probably luck my way and make it through Wheel, but there's a lot of fights later in the Elite Four that it's impossible. I'll go ahead and I'll tell you guys right now that about level 75 is the break point for me to make it through a couple of Pokemon. I did some pretty extensive testing on this, and I don't know if I could have grinded a little bit better, more efficient route, but it's just not happening. It's not very good. This is where the hard limitations of Igglybuff really take over, and this is probably Igglybuff at its worst point in the entire game. And if you guys want to know a little bit more about Wheel before we stop talking about it, even on just my second attempt after I did the one blackout, I'm able to make it past on just a second attempt. And it's not that bad. I do need some luck, like the Slowbro going for withdrawal. And outside of that, I barely survive on low health, but it is possible to get through on the very first attempt. And as far as Koga goes, I do get taken out eventually a little bit later in the fight, but you can see through the first part, Return plus Hidden Power Fire really makes short work of his team. And you can see that it really wouldn't be that long before I would eventually start to be able to consistently make it through this one. Now, there's a lot of resets. Will and Koga aren't the issue. Even at an early level, I could feasibly make it through them with a little bit of luck, but that's not really why we're grinding today. And I think we need to skip ahead just a little bit, and we need to start talking about why it's taken me so long to get through this and why I have to black out so many times. Now, let's jump all the way ahead to reset number 33. We are level 67, and we can take a look at Bruno. Now, remember, I said level 75-ish was about to where we would need to be, and at this point, Wheel and Koga have gotten much more consistent. But let's just take a look at Bruno real quick, and we can talk about some of the problematic parts. There's one main one. Hitmontop is first. I actually outspeed it at this level, and I can one-shot it with Return, so it is not an issue today. Hitmonlee is next, and it just barely outspeeds us. It will not be a problem for too much longer, but it can do some really heavy damage to us, roughly about half our health. But the silver lining is that I can one-shot it, and even though we are missing some health, we're still getting some experience, and now we look ahead at the Hitmonchan. And it's about the same thing. I outspeed it, but Mach Punch has priority. It will do some decent damage, but just like with the rest of the team that we've seen so far, I can one-shot with Return, and after we get done with that, we can start to take a look at the huge problem. This is probably the most problematic Pokemon of the entire run. It's Bruno's Machamp, and there's really only one way around this thing. It's not very fast. I actually already outspeed it, but I need to one-shot it because there's no world. I think we would have to be in our 90s to be able to survive a cross chop, and if it hits a cross chop, we're over with, so I need to one-shot it. And what's the range that we one-shot this thing at? Well, guys, it's about level 75, like I mentioned earlier. And I know in this footage, our health isn't the best. It's not like we were ever going to survive a cross chop anyway, but you got to trust me that I've played this a lot, and that's just kind of how the cookie crumbles for this one. But that's what we're working on, and I think now we can start to just kind of skip ahead some of this blackout grinding, and we can kind of go to the point to where I can actually progress past everything. And this takes us to level 73, a little bit sooner than I thought, but let's just skip ahead to that Machamp and see how it goes. And what actually gets me past it it this time, and I think maybe I should have just reset and kept the experience after I blacked out eventually further in, was that it missed a cross chop, and I guess I'll take it. I guess I did take it because that's what we're watching right now, but it's not that consistent, and it doesn't really make the rest of the Elite Four that much easier. But finally, at 37 resets in, inching ever closer to 2 hours of real life time, I finally make it past Bruno, and you would think that the worst is over, and I guess it kind of is, but at the same time, it's kind of not. Because with Karen coming up next, I immediately get hit with a sand attack, and then just from there, like a confused ray into a paralysis from the vile plume, it makes it very tough to get past, and eventually I'm just whittled down and just slowly annoyed, and I immediately have another reset, but for the first time in a very long time, I actually just reload the save. I don't black out here because I think that the worst is over, and we keep retrying on Karen. And I do have to reset quite a bit here. Everything's just kind of annoying. When you don't have any super effective answers for Karen, you get what you see here. I'm up to 41 resets, and I really just don't have the time or the patience to really give you guys a play-by-play. There's just so many things on her team that are just so annoying, whether it be things I've already talked about, like sand attack, paralysis, there's curse, there's accuracy drops. It's just very annoying, and I just kind of make it through. I do a lot of damage, I'm very over-leveled, and after some persistence and some resets, we make it past Karen, and I don't think I want to talk about Karen anymore, because after everything we've been through in this run, you can tell I sound sick, I sound nasally, I don't feel like harping on Karen. She can call a manager for all I care. Has anybody ever made that joke before? Help me, laugh please. Next up is Lance. I'm not going to give you guys this really deep play-by-play for this one as well. I do pretty well on my first attempt. Unfortunately, I can't one-hit the Gyarados, and it's able to get off some pretty decent damage with a Hyper Beam, and then the first Dragon Knight paralyzes me, and that's really what kind of does me in. I'm not fast anyway, but just that chance to miss the turn's not great, and I try to set up like a last-ditch effort rollout combo, and it would be really good if I got it going, but I can't quite get it, and I'm getting chipped down, and by the time I make it to the Aerodactyl, I'm only at 25 HP, and it just easily takes me out, and we can just take a look at the next attempt from there. And I don't mean to be too anticlimactic here, but I already have so many resets, I'm going to jump ahead to where we're at reset number 51. There's a lot of stuff you might be thinking that I'm skipping here, but at this point, I had so many resets that I was just trying to find the optimal time to use Defense Curl and roll out and sweep his team. That was about the only thing that would bring me any sort of satisfaction, and what I end up doing is just barely failing to knock out the Gyarados. I start up my Defense Curl plus rollout. I'm able to sweep past pretty much everything all the way to the very last Dragonite, and I'm just able to use Return a couple of times. Now, I'm able to barely survive this one, and I make it through, and eventually, sure, Igglybuff is the champion of the Elite Four. Everybody praised Igglybuff, it's the best, but that's not the end of our journey, folks. We still have some tough challenges left to go, and this Elite Four was not good. Hopefully, I did some justice to it, but honestly, it wasn't that interesting. I had to black out a lot to make it past Machamp, and then eventually, I had to just pick up some luck on the final two battles. That was really all there was to say about it. I ended up using Rollout Defense Curl for a lot of it. It's not really groundbreaking strategy, but it is what it is. Igglybuff has progressed, and now we have Kanto in our wake to go. And like I said with Ho-Oh, turns out to be exactly true no matter what Pokemon you're playing. Even a very weak and pathetic Pokemon like Igglybuff, the whole entirety of the Kanto side only takes about 20 minutes of real life time. It's not that bad. You can see Surge here. We just blast past everything, and instead we're only going to look at two battles, and there's a couple of key things that I pick up for the final strategies that we'll go over, but you're not missing anything when I skip over the Kanto region because we're so over leveled it's not even fun at this point. So let's skip over to a couple of the main points that you need to know about. The first thing, Enceladon is picking up leftovers inside of the restaurant, and then after that you can go to the, I don't even know what you call it, the dev building or whatever where Game Freak is. You can go up to the top floor and you can talk to the guy with the spooky story, and you can get TM03 for curse. I think this is one of the most busted moves in the entire game, and we'll talk about why I think think it's problematic looking forward at future runs, and I really like you guys to give me an opinion on this. But for now, curse, that's all you need to know. Leftovers, we're done here. Now we're going to get into some new HMs. We're at the very end of the run. We're at blue to get our final Kanto gem, and we're going to go ahead and I'm going to learn curse, and I'm going to learn rest. Those two moves right there present a very broken combo, which I think I would describe as skillless and not very fun to watch or really engage with. That's just my opinion on it. I will talk more in depth about this later, and I would really like you guys to give me feedback on it. But for a fight as hard as this, blue gave me so much trouble in practice, and we're about to see how easy this is. This little combo right here is going to trivialize the hardest fights in the game with this weak Pokemon. Igglybuff is so bad, we're about to see Igglybuff turn into a Super Saiyan monster. So we're not going to play by play each individual part of the battle here. Instead, I'm going to give you the overarching strategy here. Curse, it lowers your speed by one stage and ups your attack and your defense by one stage. You can use it 6 times, and sure, you'll be very slow and you'll get hit a lot, but if you set up in the right spot, like against Pidgeot that only has physical damage, you'll become an absolute tank and you'll be able to use rest to get back any HP. Now keep in mind, I make a mistake here. I'm still using the pink bow, and you would normally use leftovers with this strategy to make it even more safe. So eventually I just set up, I use rest, and I go on an absolute tear, and there are a couple of times that I get low, but on times like the Rhydon that only have physical damage, I'm able just to use rest, I'm able to use my very beefy defense stat just to tank everything while I'm asleep, and it's untouchable. I don't like the strategy very much, but there's no denying that it is the best strategy, and you can see that I was able to take this very tough battle and beat it on the very first attempt, and it was actually really easy. Now, looking ahead, we're going to talk about more stuff, but I would like to say that here's where I want you guys to give me your opinion on. I thought it would be more engaging if I did regular strategies all the way up to blue, and then I stopped the run right there. That's where I timed the run, and then red would be a bonus arc to where I use regular strategies, and then eventually I move into the curse rest strategy, and we see if that gets us past, if that's what we need to, because trust me guys, I think on 99.9% of Pokemon, curse and rest is going to be the strongest strategy. And when you hear people talk about, you know, hidden power and return, those being the most broken things, I think curse and rest are the easily the most broken things. And the only reason you don't see me people like calling them out more is because they're really only available pretty significantly deep into Kanto. That's just kind of my thoughts on it, and I would love to hear your guys' thoughts on that too, because I don't like it. You see a run that is this pathetic and this weak, it's about to roll over blue, it's about to roll over red with ease. Now before I fight red, I use all of my rare candies. I'm able to get up to level 90, and then I swap over to leftovers, and now we can just kind of take a look at red. And there's a lot of resets here, and it's not really for any particular reason other than Igglybuff just has very awful stats. You kind of need a specific order of things to happen for the curse rest strategy to work with a Pokemon this slow and this bad, but we'll just go over it. Now, the first thing is that you really don't want to take a charm from the Pikachu, but you can. The main thing here for Igglybuff specifically is you need around 150, 145 health to be able to survive a psychic from the Espeon. Now, if you can set up at least one curse or have a net positive of +1 attack, you can make it past. Now, here I don't reach that, and I do have a reset, and I had a couple of resets from before that, but it doesn't matter. And you can see in the next attempt, I do take a charm, and I eventually take a thunder, but after using 3 curses to get my attack back to +1 on its overall stage bonus, I'm able to take out the Pikachu. I have over that 150-ish range on my health, which means I can survive an Espeon attack, and that means return will one-shot it regardless of whatever it does, and we're able to progress to the Snorlax. And just like we talked about with blue, this is kind of your moment. All Snorlax has is physical moves, so if you get your defense up high enough, you can just rest ad nauseum, you can tank whatever damage it throws at you, and eventually you will be strong enough just to one-shot everything else. Now, with all Pokemon, Igglybuff specifically with its very low speed already, is that there's going to be a certain point to where you're going to outspeed nothing. Even the Snorlax will outspeed you with its very nice 69 speed. And it's a little bit problematic. You will have to watch your health. Maybe you'll have to rest preemptively sometimes. But once you get set up, you are extremely strong. We've seen that in the blue battle already. Here you see me just kind of mess around a little too much. I don't use rest as much as I should. And eventually I get taken out because I get too low. And I just, for some reason in my head, I'm just not thinking about the Snorlax outspeeding me, and I just let it take me out. And that's just another user error. But at this point, we have 55 resets. Nobody in the world cares. And eventually, we see how it works. Let's skip ahead to the Snorlax. I eventually get +6 attack, +6 defense. Who cares about our lowered speed? Eventually, I rest off the paralysis. I rest off the extra damage. And at that point, we're good. Leftovers start healing pretty much more than anything can do against your 436 defense. And eventually, I'm able to take it out with a single shot because we have so much attack, and that means that when things like the Venusaur come in, a single return is able to take it out. Now, I did keep rollout, but it's just not needed. Like, you could just return to so much more damage than you could ever need. You could probably even put in like a supplementary supportive move in that fourth slot if you wanted to, because it's really not needed. And at the end of the day, Blastoise doesn't do quite enough damage to knock us out, and I'm able to eventually just finish off the battle. And at level 90 might seem high, but remember, we're in the fast leveling group, and curse plus rest, if you plan it out right and you know the game pretty well, is a pretty foolproof strategy. It might take you a few times to get it, but I think it's kind of boring. And even a Pokemon that I have called very weak, very pathetic, and I had a very rough time. Remember, we were beating the Elite Four at like, what, 2 hours and 4 minutes or whatever, and we just went like in a 25 minute span and just beat Red pretty easily. So that's about it. That's all I have for you guys today. Now, I'm sure it was very apparent, but I'm sick. I'm recording this at a, I don't know what, I'm not going to date myself to when I was recording this and to when it released, but I got very sick at the start of the year, basically, and I wanted to get this video out for the end of January, and I got really sick, so I've been really nasally, and this has been like a real labor to get this video done. I had to do it in like 5 different parts, so I hope it sounds okay. I hope you guys can forgive me if the quality is not as good, but I had a lot of fun with Igglybuff, and it's kind of the lower end of the spectrum for Pokemon Gold and Silver and Crystal, I guess. It wasn't great, but it just kind of goes to show you that even Pokemon that are weak, if they're normal type, they can really abuse return. You can just manipulate your hidden power, and eventually when it comes down to it, when you make it to Kanto, you can just use Curse and Rest on pretty much any Pokemon and just dominate. So let me know what you guys think. If you make it this far in the video, I want you guys to tell me what you think about the idea of ending the run at blue and then swapping over to curse rest strategies if I have to, because it doesn't feel great to me. I know some people think hidden power is the most busted move. I personally think it's return, and then I think curse and little cheesy curse and rest strategies are right next to that pretty much. But that's about all I have for you guys today. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I guess I'll catch you guys. I got a bunch of stuff I'm working on. Hopefully it all comes out in a timely manner. I don't have to delay it, and hopefully for the next video my voice is back. I'm not nasally. I'm over all this crud, all this bad juju I've got going on. But that's the end for me. I appreciate you guys, and I think I probably haven't forgot. I probably have the members coming up on the screen right now. I almost forgot, but love you guys. I'll see you on the next video. Bye. Mm-hmm.